I think I'm going to start with a story. So, before I ever started practicing, when I was younger, I was a single mom. I had a little boy that was, I guess Red would have been about 5 years old. And my youngest, Thaddeus, would be like a pouch baby. So he was all, as long as he was down in the pouch, he was cool. He wasn't really a problem at all. Raymond, on the other hand, was, all over the place. So through a whole bunch of circumstances that I don't really care about anymore, I ended up getting kicked out of my apartment. And I had nowhere to go, and I stayed at this emergency shelter for about maybe 2 months, I think, maybe 2 or 3 months before I got an apartment. And it was downtown Seattle, and the shelter was right above a coffee shop. And every day I would go and get coffee and catch a bus from the shelter to take Thaddeus to his daycare and then take Raymond to his school. And then I would catch a bus to go to work. And then I would reverse it every night, go get Raymond. Then we'd go get Thaddeus and then we'd go back to the shelter. I did this for maybe 2 or 3 months. The story really isn't about the shelter, it wasn't a big deal. It's what happened that I want to tell you about. So every morning, workday morning, pretty much every morning, Daddy Raymond would get up in a jump and say, "Do we have time? Do you think we'll have time to go get coffee?" And he would start in this process. "Do you think we're going to have time to get coffee? What do you think, Mama? You think we can get done quick enough? We can get the coffee?" And I'm like, "Yes, if you would go get yourself ready. Yes." And what he meant was, why this barista did this, I have no idea. But I would buy myself coffee and I would buy him chocolate milk. But the barista put it in a hot cup. And so he thought he had coffee, just like me. He had milk. So the bus stop, to my good fortune, was right outside of this coffee shop. So we would get the coffee and we would go outside and sit and wait for this bus. Oh my God. It was pristine quiet outside. And I can remember hearing traffic. I mean, we had to get up really early for me to do all this. And we would sit outside with the bus, and I would hear Thaddeus, I mean, Raymond, blowing on his coffee to keep it cool, drinking his coffee. And he would ask me things like, "What did I think about the president? What kind of jobs are available? What is it like to go to work?" And he just was inquisitive. And what I remember about this whole period, what I can feel in my body and remember, is the tranquility I felt, pristine stillness. And I was not that kind of person. The kind of person I was back then, this is way before Dhamma. I was aggressive. I was always worried about things and over planning, drama city all the time. Worried, 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 worried. But yet, for these 2 or 3 months, Raymond and I would sit there. And I could hear the cars. I could hear just, I don't know, people talking. It was just tranquil. I was peaceful. And I could hear Raymond blowing on his coffee and asking me these unbelievable questions. And we would sit and talk about all kinds of things, things that had nothing to do with my circumstances. I went, dropped him off. I used to look forward to picking him up, but we'd have these long talks all the way back home. I never appreciated what was happening in that moment. Never. I didn't understand it. I'm glad I was not problematic and I went about my life. And then when I started coming into stillness, I began to realize back in that moment that I was still. That's what it was. I wasn't complaining about why I was in a shelter. What am I going to do? I wasn't worried. I didn't add anything to it. It was just get up in the morning, go downstairs, get our coffee, catch the bus, go to work. That's it. And something about realizing that moment is what changed my mind, changed my understanding about Nibbana and trying to access Nibbana and what it was. Because I came from a Christian upbringing, so I thought Nibbana, awakening, enlightenment, whatever you want to call it, it's like going to heaven. And so I'm going to get there one day. But when I tasted that first sense of like tranquility, stillness, is when I realized that Buddha must have been talking about something completely different. He wasn't talking about making yourself get to some state where you have transcended all difficulties. We don't have to transcend all difficulties. There is a way for us to be free regardless of whether or not there's difficulties or not. But in order for us to sort of see that, we have to begin to pay attention to what's happening. Because even though I had the capacity to be very still and tranquil, even back when I was in my drama-filled days, I didn't have any access to it. I couldn't find it. I couldn't grab it. I couldn't even tell you how come me and Raymond got along and I wasn't snapping at him every 2 minutes. I was actually listening to him. But usually I was in some state, but it just so happened. Maybe my mind was overwhelmed with where I was. I have no idea. All I know is that in that state, in that moment in time, I was free. It didn't matter what was going on. I was happy, easy, simple. And that's what I think Buddha was pointing to with this third noble truth. He was not pointing to trying to get to some world where we no longer have difficulties. He's pointing to something else. So I want to read a few suttas, because the biggest problem about some of this, I think, is because we hear it. We hear someone say Nibbana, talk about Nibbana. We hear someone talk about enlightenment or talk about awakening, or we hear about it and we begin to formulate in our mind what that could be. Must be something spectacular because it's not anything I could access. But that's not the way the Buddha talked about it. Here's one way he talked about it. It's in Ajahn Sumedho's book on the Four Noble Truths. He said, what is the noble truth of the cessation of suffering? It is the remainderless fading and cessation of that same craving that he talked about as the cause of dukkha, that same craving, the rejecting, relinquishing, leaving, and renouncing of it. But whereon is this craving abandoned and made to cease? Wherever there is what seems lovable and gratifying, thereon it is abandoned and made to cease. It's sort of this idea here. What a couple of things I like about the way he says this. One, he uses a whole bunch of words. So I looked all these words up, right? He said remainderless. He said that it is the remainderless, and the remainderless is what remains after everything else is gone. But there's no residue. It's the remainder after you've let go of craving. That doesn't have anything to do with going anywhere. You let go of craving, whatever is left, this is what he's saying cessation is, whatever's left, whatever it is. He calls it the fading, the remainderless fading and cessation of this craving. So it is the leaving. So what I experienced at this bus stop was all of the craving that I would have normally had towards trying to fix my situation. Why am I here? Blaming somebody, wanting it to be better. All of that was gone. And all I had was me and Raymond sitting at the bus stop. That's it. That's all that was there. Talking about politics to a 5-year-old who sounded like he understood. I didn't even know he knew about presidents and jobs and, you know, but it was just talking. Thaddeus is tucked inside. He's happy. Everybody's happy. And that is the point that I think the Buddha was pointing to. He said that it was the rejecting, relinquishing, leaving, and renouncing of it. This, all of these words, to me, point to this idea that we may not, in any given moment, it may show up in different ways. In some moments, we have to reject craving. In some moments, we have to renounce it. You know, I'm not doing it. In some moments, we have to release it or let it go. There are all these different ways that we have to let go of some attachment. So the thing that always tripped me up on the sutta, though, is he said that wherever there is what seems lovable and gratifying, thereon it is abandoned and made to cease. When I read the sutta in the early days of my practice, I thought he was saying I had to let go of whatever was lovable and gratifying, that that's what I had to let go of in order for me to have awakened. That is not what he's saying. He's saying it is the craving of that, the craving of something lovable. And so the craving of something lovable and gratifying in the situation with me at the bus stop would have been probably where I was when I was realizing I was going to have to move out of my apartment. In that moment, I was probably frantic, mad, craving something not to happen, craving this staying the way I wanted it to be, staying, this is what I want, so this is what I'm craving. And somehow I let that go. Somehow, over the course of a day or two, I let go of craving for something to be otherwise. And I allowed what was left by letting go of wanting this to be otherwise, what was left was just me and Raymond sitting at the bus stop. It was beautiful. And to this day, I have tried to remember what I felt like before that bus stop, and I cannot. I can remember how I was generally, but I can't remember all of the negativity that must have been showing up. I can't even imagine me not yelling at somebody. about me losing my apartment. But all of that is gone. It's not even important. What became important was the bus stop. So there's another way that the Buddha described this. He was walking, I guess, with his monks, or he was with his monks. And so I'm going to change this to practitioners. He said he was picking up a bit of dust on his fingertip. And he said to the practitioners, "What do you think, practitioners? Which is greater? The bit of dust I picked up with the tip of my fingernail, or the great earth?" Trick question. They said, the great earth is far greater. The little bit of dust that you have on your fingernail is next to nothing. It's not a hundredth, a thousandth, a 100,000th. This little bit of dust that you have picked up on your fingernail, when compared to the great earth, is nothing. You can see that. I can see that. So then the Buddha said, in the same way, for a practitioner who is consummate in view, says consummate in view, an individual who has broken through the suffering and the stress that is totally ended and extinguished is far greater. That which remains is a state of having, that which remains in the state, it's not a hundredth, a thousandth, a 100,000th when compared with the previous mass of suffering. That's how great the benefit is of breaking through to the Dhamma practitioners. That's how great the benefit is of obtaining the Dhamma eye. So when I read this short little sutta, it struck me. First, I had never heard of the word Dhamma eye. What would that mean, this Dhamma eye? And it was the first time that I realized that the Buddha wasn't even talking about somebody who's fully enlightened. This is someone who has broken through to a place of the Dhamma where they have opened this Dhamma eye. They still got to practice, but they've opened this Dhamma eye. And just in the moment of opening your Dhamma eye, you have turned your entire suffering for the future like a bit of dust on someone's finger. And all the suffering that you've endured up to that point is like the great earth. Just by opening your Dhamma eye. I don't think I ever fully understood until I started reading this sutta just how important perception is. Perception, understanding, how we view a moment in time. And then the practice itself began to make more sense to me. The practice began to, I'd say, it began to open up. Everything changed because every single thing in my life, everything I started doing, I wanted to know, how was I perceiving it? Like, how did something come into be? How come I was mad? In fact, when I would go to work, I would tell people, oh, I feel all this anger energy around me. There's anger energy around me. I felt anger energy. And people at my job, you know, I was a prosecutor, and they'd say, "Why don't you just say you're angry, Tuere?" I said, "No, I don't know if it's me. I'm not sure. It could be the defendant's anger. It could be the judge's anger. It could be your anger. It could be anybody's anger. I don't know whose anger it is, but I feel anger around me." It would get sort of like this. I would begin to recognize, I used to look at things. I wouldn't let anything go by without looking at it, analyzing, what am I seeing here? And I wanted to see the conditionality of it. It's not just anger. It's anybody could say, okay, take this class on anger management and try to work on your anger. That's not what's awakening, just because you can get rid of your anger. I mean, I spent a boatload of money. Well, I didn't really get rid of my anger, but I spent a boatload of money trying to get rid of my anger. It's not the getting rid of your anger. What he was pointing to is that anger exists because a series of things happen in a systematic, lawful way. And when you begin to understand this happens, then this happens, then this happens, then this happens, when you begin to understand that, you will let that anger go, abandon it, just let it go. Somehow, I think when I got to that shelter, I was so grateful to be in that shelter that I let go of how I got there. I didn't really care how I got there. And because I didn't really care how I got there, I let go of all the blame, all the, what I would have done is crave. I would have continued to crave being back in my apartment, but I didn't. I just let it go. This is what I think the Buddha was pointing to, is that somehow or another, if we can begin to see what we are holding on to, that's what that craving is, what we are holding on to or trying to make show up, even though it's not here, that is where our suffering is coming from. And when we let go of the trying to make something happen that's not here, or let go of something that has passed on, when we learn to let that go and be with life just as it is in the present moment, arriving, then what's left, what's remainder is like a little bit of dust on the fingertip. But the remainder of it is, it's not stressful. I always point to this moment sitting at the bus stop, realizing that, because I just know from being around homeless people, not having a place to stay is stressful in and of itself. But the stress level of not craving my previous existence, that was more stressful than the stress of just getting up, riding the bus with Red, going to my job, working, and I had to work until I could save up money and get an apartment. And all of that all came in time. But the remainder energy, not stressful at all. It's not just that the suffering that we go through from, some feeling tone starts with some, you see something and that contact with it sets in motion this whole arising of links, and it gets to this feeling tone, and then we react to it some way and crave what we wish we had, or hold on to something that's leaving. That's really all it is. It's in the enjoyable, because we only crave what's enjoyable. We don't crave what is unpleasant or not enjoyable. What we're doing is craving something that we enjoy and regretting something that may be present that we don't like. So there's always this craving for something better, or trying to hold on to what is good right now so it doesn't ever leave me. But there's another conditioning that I also begin to notice. And sometimes we dwell so much as practitioners on seeing the conditioning of how our suffering comes into being, that we forget that the Buddha said there's another conditioning that happens also. And that conditioning has to do with another sutta that I want to read that I think it's just beautiful. So first he says, first there's this. He says, just as when the rain pours in heavy drops and crashes, thunders on the upper mountains, the water flowing along the slopes fills the mountain clefts and rifts and gullies. And when the mountain clefts and rifts and gullies are full, they fill the little ponds. They overflow and they fill the ponds. And when the little ponds are full, they fill the big lakes. They overflow and go into the lakes. And when the big lakes are filled, they overflow and fall into rivers. And when the little rivers are full, they fill the big rivers. And when the big rivers are full, they fill the great ocean. And in the same way, this is the way practice is. This is what I think Buddha wanted people to understand. What he found was not the cure for our discontent. What he found was he saw what led to suffering and what led away from suffering. And both of them are like this. They both pour into another, into another, into another, into another. So this is what he said about the other side, not the suffering side. He says, for when a person endowed with virtue, consummate in virtue, there is no need for an act of will, or begging, I should say, may freedom from remorse arise in me, because it is the nature of things that freedom from remorse arises in a person endowed with virtue, consummate in virtue. Everything about this practice is cultivating our level of virtue. Everything. We're not going to necessarily, even the precepts, they're not edicts. Thou shalt do this and thou shalt not do this. It's not that. It's a training apparatus to help you learn how not to cause harm, not to take what's not freely offered, not to, you know, have misconduct with your sexuality or, you know, speak in harsh words. It's a training apparatus that we learn how to move in the world. So when this consummate in virtue is like you are training in the way to be. You are training in how to discern non-harm. And for a person who's free from remorse, as you train, you're going to get less and less and less remorseful because you're going to notice your behavior, notice your actions, notice what's happening. So as that, there's no need to act to, there's no need for an act of will. May joy arise in me, because it is the nature of things for joy to arise in a person free from remorse. It's just going to happen. The more you let go of all your unskillful habits, the more joy you're going to get, period. Whether you want to or not doesn't really have anything to do with you. It is the nature of things for joy to arise in you. If for a joyful person, there's no need to for an act of will. May, you know, this rapture arise in me. It's the nature for it to arise. May I have a serene body. You don't have to beg for that. It's going to happen. You just stay on the practice and it's going to happen. It doesn't have anything to do with you. That's the thing I had to come to understand. Cessation had nothing to do with me. I didn't have to make it happen. It was going to happen. if I just kept practicing diligently with my sincere intention. And it goes on, and he goes on and on and on. May I experience pleasure? You don't have to beg for that. It's going to happen. And the mind, when you start experiencing pleasure, the mind's going to get concentrated, just because it gets concentrated. When the mind starts getting concentrated, you don't have to beg to see things as they actually are. You will. This kind of seeing, this moving towards cessation and liberation comes naturally with the practice. It's part of the practice. And there's nothing that you have to beg or push for. It seems to me when the Buddha was talking about his practice, about having a bit of dust on his fingernail. And he said that this is what happens for someone who opens the Dhamma eye. I wanted to know, what is this Dhamma eye? I've never heard of it. I think some people call it stream entry, and there's all these words for it, but I'm going to give you my take on what I think actually starts happening to you when you open this Dhamma eye. First, you begin to see harm. You see it. You know it. You see it when you're sitting. You see it in your conduct. It's why I was able to see that woman's do that kind of side eye at my job, because you see it. You can feel it. You know it. I was on a retreat one time, and a really good friend of mine, this BIPOC woman, she was walking with a white woman, and the white woman had this kind of olive green skin tone. And I didn't even think about it, but I looked at this white woman's skin and I said, oh my God, your skin is so beautiful. It was in the way the light was showing on it or something. I said, it's so beautiful. It's such a beautiful color. My friend, there was this moment, a little awkward. Nobody said anything. And we were right before we got into the door. And so the moment passed right on by. And then towards the end of my retreat, my friend is brown skin. And she said, oh, Tuere, we haven't had a chance to talk. Can we talk? And I'm like, oh, I've been waiting for our opportunity to go walking and talking. So we start walking. I'm so happy. I thought we were going to talk about all kinds of, how you been? She said, no, no, she wanted to talk about that moment. And I said, well, I mean, I wasn't trying to hurt you. I mean, come on now, really. She goes, nobody ever says my skin is beautiful. I'm like, well, that's your thing. That's not me. What are you talking about? I was getting a little testy. Like, why are you putting your issue on me? This is for you to practice with. Just let it go. It was a compliment. And it wasn't your compliment. It was someone else's compliment. Let it go. She's like, no, you don't understand that this really offended me when you said this. And I remember pushing and pushing, like, you need to get yourself together. You can't put all your drama on me. But I have been a Dhamma eye that's opened up. And I could feel as I was walking some suffering. I could feel some pain, some tension. I don't know whose it is. It could be hers, could be mine. I don't know, but I feel some tension. And if I feel tension, I'm gonna stop. Just not gonna happen. I'm not going any further. We gotta wait a minute. So I stopped and I said, okay, just a minute, just a minute. Let me think. So I settled down into the body and I said, look, I don't know who's suffering here, me or you, but I feel like there's too much suffering to just ignore. Let me just see. You tell me, what does it feel like? And then she told me what it feels like to be a brown-skinned person in a world that looks upon light skin as being beautiful. I don't think anybody's ever really said that to me. I mean, I'm a light-skinned person and I think of myself as black, but I walk around in a world where it's very different for me than it is for my siblings who are all brown-skinned. So I'm standing there listening to her and I am feeling how painful this was. How harmful this was to her. Whether I meant it or not really is irrelevant. I was just feeling the pain she felt. So I was very apologetic. Told her I was sorry. And I'm thinking to myself, how am I going to make this right? So we get to the big ending debrief and we're all the volunteers were there. And I told them, I told the whole room what I had said, what I had done, that I was sorry, didn't mean it, and how harmful it was. And I wanted them to know that not just white people mess up, but BIPOC people, we do too. It's just this thing. And that my willingness to take on the suffering and then admit it, it frees me from the pain of it. And so I needed to share it and be honest and upfront about it. But that moment, she just like jumps up. She's like, thank you so much. Thank you so much. So I think that it's one thing that we harm, but then we try to keep it on the down low. I didn't mean that. And I said it out loud to everyone, this harm that I had done, and cleared the air of it, made a amends of it. And that this is what I think the Buddha was trying to point to, is for us to begin to see harm, not just the harm someone does to us, but the harm someone does to someone else, the harm that animals do to each other, the harm that happens all the time, earth to earth, all of us, it's everywhere. There's so much harm that goes on in the world, but we don't want to see it as miserable. Like I gotta live in a miserable state. We want to see harm as a way to see the alleviation of harm. Where does it, how do you alleviate it? We have to discern that. And you can't discern how to alleviate harm if you don't see it, if you don't begin to see it. So that's what I think he really wanted to bring out. And tomorrow when we talk about the path, we're going to talk a little bit more about how his approach on how to handle this. And the next thing you see is kindness. So even though you see harm everywhere, and this world is full of harm, you also see kindness. I cannot believe my kindness is more mudita than it is friendliness, metta. I'm not the compassion, metta, or the upekkha. I'm more of the mudita. I am, oh my God, I'm like the mudita queen. And I like stumbled into some space of joy and I see it everywhere. I think of it all the time. I think of all the people. If I have a, let's say I feel something that makes me happy, like my granddaughter calls me and I'm talking to her. And then I think about all the grandmothers that must be thinking about their granddaughters and all the grandfathers and how happy they must be. And there's so much joy. And here's my point on this. This this is probably gonna be a hard thing to say, but I'm gonna say it. There is so much misery in the world. There's so many people that are in miserable circumstances. And I mean righteously miserable circumstances. That's not us. We are not in that. We might be into some difficult situations, but we are not in the misery at the level that some people are in. And I have been in really, really bad states. But the thing that is important when you're in a really bad state is somewhere there has to be some level of inspiration, some happiness. So to me, when we live in a country that has so much access and we are all walking around miserable, and there are people that live in dire straits, where are they going to get their joy from? Where are they going to get their inspiration from? Who can give it to them? It can't be them. They don't have it. It's got to be the people who actually have the possibility for that joy. So if we walked around with joy, we would put joy back in the world. But what's happening, and I feel it all over the place, is that there's so much misery, and then we find out about other people's misery, and then we feel like we got to be miserable too. And now everybody's miserable. We cannot do that. We cannot live this way. When I think about the civil rights, I didn't live in the civil rights. But when I think about the civil rights, what I noticed is the way people lived before the civil rights. I can't even imagine the level of fear you had to live with as a Black person or anybody of color, gay people, pretty much anybody. But really, I know from a Black perspective how difficult it must have been. I believe I would have been strung up somewhere because my mouth is just way too sharp. I'm gonna be in trouble with somebody because I'm gonna say something. And at the same time, there were laws preventing you from doing things, right? Laws on the books, freedoms that white people had that we didn't have. So how come I don't live that way now? And it is because people went to church, just where it happens to be, and they started singing to the rafters. The joy level, the joy button got pushed up really, really high. Because if you're going to go and face power, you are going to have some joy. You are going to have some uplift, some meaning to the whole thing, some laughter. You have to have that. Or you will be defeated. We are not going to be free if we're walking around in misery. We have to build up some level of joy in order for us to see another day. So the people that carry that burden is us. People who have some reason to be joyous, even if it's not all perfect. We're the ones that have to send that mudita out in the world over and over and over and over. And I believe I send it out all the time because I believe somewhere in Palestine, somebody is like, hey, what is that? That's all I need them to do. What is that energy? I feel that's all I need. If I keep sending it your way, it's not like I can go there. I can't do anything. I don't know anyone. I'd be in the way. I don't even know the culture. I'd be in the way. But what I can do, I send mucho grande joy all the time, all the time, all the time, all the time. So you may not be connected to joy. It may be compassion. It may be metta friendliness. It may be just steady, steady, steady upeka. That's what our job is, to send this energy, this create this whole big old bubble to move it through. Well, let me get lost in mudita because I could be staying in that forever. The second thing we need to do, so this is what the Dhamma eye sees. It sees kindness, it sees harm, and then it sees conditionality. It sees patterns. It sees habit energies. It sees the systems and structures of the way things unfold. It's nothing wrong with what you're seeing. You are all seeing. I can hear it in the meetings. You're all seeing this, like, well, you say it like it's a problem. I see that I do this. Instead of saying, hey, I see what I am doing. I see that. That's what Dhamma sees. It sees the habit patterns, even the habit patterns that constantly cause us harm, or the habit patterns that we wish we could break. It sees it all the time. It's not, you don't have to worry about how do I stop all these habit patterns. You will stop them because one consummate in virtue will be free of remorse. It's a done deal. It already is going to happen. But we have to learn to be able to see just how conditional everything is, just what's actually happening. We have to see how we're moving in the world. We have to see how the world is moving, see how all these things are coming together. And then finally, so you see conditionality, you see this kind of kindness everywhere. You see where it's at. You see that kindness, friendliness, metta is real. It's not just when you're a nice person. It's very much a real aspect of the world. And you see harm. And the last thing you see is stillness. You see it everywhere. I see stillness everywhere. I see it underneath all things. I don't have that sense of panic like I used to have. For the bulk of my life, I was a panic-driven person. In fact, you know, the fact that I'm right because I'm a Virgo and then panicking, you know, everybody in my family was probably glad that I found the Dhamma. But there's a way in which I started seeing stillness. And so what it means is, I don't panic. It's the lack of panic that I notice that happens. It's not that I don't get worried about things or get upset about something. I don't have that panic, pushing, shoving. We got to make this change. We got to make this work. The way I used to be was much more of a panic-driven person. So anything I didn't know or didn't like, I would panic until I got it fixed. And now there are things I don't like and I don't want and whatever, but I don't panic underneath. It's still, it's much more, I can be with whatever's going to happen. So there's a way, there is a quality of stillness that exists. It's you can call it stillness, you can call it well-being, you can call it, you know, it's this liberative mind that can be with difficulty without panic, without the overload. So see, this idea of stillness and kindness and conditionality and harm, all of these qualities are something that we have access to right now. It's not something that you're going to have to sort of work on for the rest of your days to maybe you come with it. It's how diligent you work on your practice. It's pure and simple. You give a little bit of effort in your practice. Its stillness is still coming, but it's going to take a little bit longer. You put a lot of effort in it. It's going to be shorter. People give up their whole lives and join the monastery. They get it much quicker. I didn't need to join a monastery. I just had to be diligent and sincere in my practice. That's it. And in that diligence, I'm not trying to fix me. I don't have to fix me. I'm fine the way I am. What I have to do is just be willing, see harm, see this conditionality, look for kindness and where it's at. And then I begin to recognize the stillness. So I want to read a quote from Alice Walker, and then I'm going to read a poem. Oh, 144. So here's a quote from Alice Walker. Alice Walker, also Black writer, female writer that writes some beautiful work, activists and everything. She says, some periods of our growth are so confusing that we don't even recognize that growth is happening. We may feel hostile and angry, or weepy and hysterical, or we may feel depressed. It would never occur to us, unless we stumbled on a book or a person who explained it to us, that we were in fact in a process of change, of actually becoming larger spiritually than we were before. Whenever we grow, we seek to break out of its shell. Whenever we grow, we tend to feel it as a young seed must feel the weight and inertia of the earth as it seeks to break out of its shell on its way to becoming a plant. Can you imagine that? The earth is just there, solid, and you're trying to break up out of a shell against the backdrop of that. Often the feeling is anything but pleasant, but what is most unpleasant is the not knowing what is happening. Those long periods when something inside ourselves seems to be waiting, holding its breath, unsure about what the next step should be, eventually become the periods we wait for. For it is in those periods that we realize that we are being prepared for the next phase of our life, and that in all probability, a new level of the personality is about to be revealed. So in some respects, this, what I think Alice Walker is pointing to, is craving is like the earth. It's inertia, it's heavy, it's got us locked into some position. And we need to break out of this shell so we can open this Dharma eye. But to break out of that shell is not easy. It probably feels unpleasant and heavy, like it's not actually happening. This little bitty plant is pushing up against this hard shell, and the shell is completely consumed by dirt. But they just keep pushing, keep pushing, keep pushing, keep pushing until eventually they come out. So the last thing I want to share is this poem by Pat Snyder called Instructions for the Journey. It says, the self you leave behind is only a skin you've outgrown. Don't grieve for it. Look to the wet, raw, unfinished self, the one you are becoming. The world too sheds its skin, politicians, catechisms, ordinary days. It's easy to lose this tenderly unfolding moment. Look for it as if it were the first green blade after a long winter. Listen for it as if it were the first clear tone in a place where dawn is heralded by bells. And if all else fails, wash your own dishes, rinse them, stand in the kitchen at your sink, let the cold water run through your fingers and just feel it. That's it. Let's sit a moment.